I'm going to teach you about compiler directives and how to use them to make your life easier when building your iOS apps in Xcode. And to do that, I'll show you how I'm personally using them in my codebase for my indie app, Creator View. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. The first example of a compiler directive I'll show you is how to use platform-specific code. So Creator View is available for iPhone, iPad, and the Mac. So sometimes I want to conditionally run code only for iOS or only for macOS. So here in my app, in SwiftUI, my app protocol, oh, by the way, here's my disclaimer. As you can see, 8.24.21. I haven't touched this code base in a couple years. It's also my own personal project. I know we all love to dissect the code. Feel free to do it, but just know that I am not claiming that this code you're going to see here is like perfect code you should emulate. Oh, I saw it in Sean's video, so I should do it. Absolutely not. We're just here for the compiler directives. But you see the first one right here. And the way you write them is hashtag if space OS, and then in parentheses, you know, iOS, macOS, whatever, right? You see this if OS macOS, see this if OS iOS, and then you have to write end if. So what I'm doing right here in my window group, right? I have my navigation structure, which is a custom thing I did because I use a tab bar on the iPhone and a navigation split view on iPad and Mac. But anyway, you know, this will be your content view or whatever it is. And what you see here is I say, hey, if it's macOS, I need a minimum width of 1100 and a maximum height of 750. And what that does, if I go to actually Creator View Mac app, that just makes it so I can't make it smaller, right? I can make it bigger, but I have a minimum height. So that's all I'm doing there. But you see, I only apply that if it's on macOS. And if you look at my target here, my target's iOS. So that is why this code is grayed out. So that's what's nice. I believe that was in Xcode 15, that if you're not actually targeting it, it'll kind of dim it out. But you can see here, hey, if I'm doing iOS, that's when I'll go ahead and schedule my app refresh. If I'm on macOS, add commands. By the way, commands are like menu bar options. And then this settings view is only available on macOS. So you need to put the if OS macOS compiler directive here. Another example here in the goal list view is I have a different navigation title and navigation title display mode based on if I'm on the iOS or macOS. And here's what the navigation title looks like on iOS, and then here's what it looks like on macOS. So again, in SwiftUI, the whole idea is to kind of like write it once and be able to use it on multiple platforms, right? Like a list will look different on the iPhone versus a Mac, you know, it will adapt accordingly to the platform. So that's what I'm doing here. This goal list view, I am sharing on both iPhone and Mac. And the only difference I had to do is just kind of change the navigation title because it worked out that way. Now, it doesn't always work out that way. So here is maybe the downside of these compiler directives that I want to share is here's my scrolling paywall view. And here's what it looks like real quick on the iPhone. You can see me scrolling just to give you some context. But look at my note. I'm experimenting with a highly combined view file between iPhone, iPad, and Mac. And I have reasons for it I won't get into in the video. But basically, you'll see this is maybe the downside if you're trying to share too much code, because look, an iPhone and a Mac, they're very different form factors. So the code might not be easily shareable, but you'll have these compiler directives everywhere, right? If OS, iOS, and if OS, macOS, and if iOS, and if. So this is an example of maybe having, you know, too many compiler directives to where the code is super confusing. So maybe the scrolling paywall might be better if I just have two separate files for Mac and iOS. But again, like I said in the comment, like I was experimenting with a highly combined file just to see what it was like. But this does point out maybe the downside of trying to share too much code in SwiftUI. So, okay, I think you got the gist of the compiler directives for different platforms. And it can be iOS, watchOS, tvOS, visionOS, macOS, all that stuff. Now let's talk about different modes here. And you'll see how I'm using my persistence file because you can also do if debug. If you're not familiar, you pretty much have two modes when you're building your app in Xcode. You have debug mode, which is when you run it on the simulator or even run it on your device. And then you have production, which is actually on the app store. So how I'm using this here is this is my Swift data container. And when I'm on the simulator or if I'm in debug mode, I want my Swift data model container to be stored in memory only, which means I'm not persisting the data, right? The whole point of Swift data is when you enter all the data in, it persists in between launches. Well, like I said, it's easier for testing and building if I don't have to deal with stored data. I just basically wipe the memory clean every time I rerun the app. So rather than like changing that every time I ran it or launched to the app store, you just have this compiler directive that says, hey, if I'm in debug mode, go ahead and give me my model configuration where it's just in memory only. I'm not storing anything. Else, which means I'm in production, and you see this is grayed out because I am in debug mode. But anyway, if I'm in production, then go ahead and send it to my real CloudKit database and Swift data database. So basically what this means is when I'm building on the simulator or on my device, I'm not really using Swift data because that just caused more headaches. However, when I do launch it to test flight or the app store, then I'm actually using Swift data. Now we can get a little more granular with this. You know, let's say I wanted to keep the same concept, but instead of all debug modes, like maybe I only wanted to do target, environment, simulator. See, I get the autocomplete. So what this does, and I hate how it doesn't indent, there might be a setting there, but I always tab them over to indent them. Basically what this means is like, hey, when I'm running this on the simulator, cool, now do this in stored memory container only. But if I ran it on my device and I'm not on the simulator, then I would use the real Swift data container and all that. So when I had just if debug, that is all debug modes, whether it's my device or the simulator, but I can do specifically simulator as well if I want, you know, more granularity there. And lastly, I want to talk about hashtag warning and hashtag error. So hashtag warning will provide these yellow warnings here. So I typed this. I typed hashtag warning and then whatever string I wanted to do. So basically I said refactor. I'm putting everything in here till I get it working. So my goalless view model is like ridiculous. You know, again, don't judge the code because I was just trying to get it to work. And I left this note here. It's kind of like a to-do that says, hey, come back and fix this. And the reason I like to use hashtag warning is because in my project, I don't like warnings, right? So when I click on these warnings, I try to clear all of these. So my little to-do notes will show up in my warning list over here on the left. Now, to take this even further, let's say I was working on this goal list view model and I did hashtag error. And this is how I usually use this. I do, this is where I left off. And then I will do, you know, very detailed comments to let future Sean know where to start. And how I use this is, let's say I'm in the middle of a feature, and you know what it's like building a feature. You're trying to maintain this giant puzzle in your head and you're really concentrating, and then you got this meeting or you got lunch or you get interrupted, something. So what hashtag error does is you can't even build and run the project. The warning, you can still build and run it. But like, let's say I left this hashtag error, this is where I left off, and I come back and maybe my screen got switched. Maybe it went back to the goal list view. And I come back like 3 hours later, I forgot where I was, right? Then I'm like, okay, where was I again? And I try to run the project. Well, it's not even gonna let me run it because I have this error over here. This is where I left off. Oh, and then I see my detailed notes. So again, hashtag warning will still let you run the project. It just puts a warning there. But if you do hashtag error, you can't build the project. You can't do anything. Your build will fail. And again, I use this if I have the code in a spot that is like maybe dangerous and I don't want to let myself continue without forgetting to finish what I did, I'll put up this error, say this is where I left off, and leave very detailed notes so I remind myself where to pick up when I get back. So that's hashtag warning and hashtag error. Again, we talked about the if OS, macOS, tvOS, iOS, whatever, to do things conditionally based on the platform. And then we have the if debug or if simulator to only run certain code when you're running it on the simulator or in debug mode. And if you're here learning about compiler directives, I know you really care about building some awesome iOS apps. And I think it's best to have a portfolio website to showcase your work. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.